Hi, thank you very much, Audra.
Thank you.
All right. So today we're talking about Spark on Mesos, and these are both a couple of projects that have a lot of active development around them, a lot of very interesting use cases. So I'm very pleased to be working with them together. To get started here, let's see, we're going to cover this in a few different sections. First off, I'm going to give a bit of an overview about what Apache Mesos is. Apache Spark, we'll talk a bit about that, but it's probably more popularized. There's a wider audience. Mesos is definitely gaining a lot of momentum, and I want to cover, really what it's used for, what some of the use cases are. From there, we'll launch a Mesos cluster in the Amazon AWS cloud. There's a free tier service for doing this, and so if you have an account on Amazon AWS, you can follow along, launch your own cluster. Definitely encourage people to do that. After that, once we've got a cluster running, we'll get an email notification. For those of you who follow along, I'll go through the steps to configure and run Spark on a Mesos cluster. It's not that many steps. It's actually pretty quick, and there's a tutorial that you can literally cut and paste the commands to get this going. And then from there, we'll have Spark running. We'll have an interactive prompt that we call a REPL. So you can type in different variables or functions that you want to evaluate and see the jobs running. And this will be running in parallel out on the cluster. So we'll run a sample job, and I'll point everyone towards a lot more examples if you want to drill down on this, do more of a deep dive. But what's interesting is that while we're running these jobs, there's a console for Spark, and there's a console for Mesos. And for that matter, if you want to dive into the console for AWS, we can see how all the different components are working. I'll show some screenshots of that, but also give you some URLs if you want to run through that in your own clusters. And then from there, there's a number of other resources. This is just a real high-level overview. There's great resources for Mesos and Spark. In particular, there's the Strata SC conference coming up in just a couple of weeks, and we'll be having a lot of excellent content about both open-source projects at Strata. All righty, thank you. Let's get started then. A little bit of background about Apache Mesos. The main topic that I want to present about Apache Mesos, the main concept, is what's being called data center computing. This is something that Google has been talking about for a number of years, practicing at very large scale for a number of years to address the complexities that they have of very large scale data workflows, a lot of machine learning, a lot of the things the rest of the industry is really kind of catching up to. We talk about MapReduce and things like that that have, open source now. Hadoop has been open source MapReduce for a number of years. So, excuse me. So when we talk about data center computing, there's a really important point there, is that Google leverages features of the modern Linux kernel. That is to say, using isolation and kernel as opposed to using virtual machines. And there are very important reasons for this. It's also quite a departure from industry practices where, typically you're using different types of virtual machines, hypervisors, VMware, et cetera. It's interesting to note that Google is among the top 10 open source contributors to the Linux kernel. And in particular, there is an area of the Linux kernel called cgroups, which is, if you're familiar with, say, Solaris operating system in Unix, there's been features in Solaris for a long time called zones. Cgroups does a similar kind of thing where it provides isolation. You can go in and specify how much resources you want a process to use and have guarantees at the kernel level that you use just that. Now, when Google does analysis, some of which they've published, of their cluster traces as well as public cluster traces from Yahoo, Twitter, Facebook, et cetera, other big internet firms, an interesting thing shows up. Most of the jobs that run on these clusters are batch jobs, which is kind of what you'd figure. But most of the resources get used for services. And that's a very important point. Batch jobs are, you know, there's a lot of those, but the services are really the critical part, and it's where people throw resources at for clusters. As a result, when you look across the industry, you know, you see single-digit percentage points of utilization rates in clusters in enterprise IT, you know, maybe like 8% utilization. What that means is a lot of capital expense, a lot of operator time, a lot of power, because basically the clusters are mostly idle. So what Google has pushed with the concept of data center computing is how to get away from having all that idle time being wasted, because it's money, it's energy, it's heat, it's et cetera. And so by leveraging this notion of isolation, C groups, then they can take a big data center, warehouse scale data center, and run mixed workloads on it, leveraging what we call multi-tenancy. So that is to say, maybe there's a bunch of MapReduce jobs running, but there's also a bunch of web apps, and there's some other kinds of reporting and some streaming, and just many different sizes and shapes of jobs and processes all running together. They're not on separate clusters. And this leads to realization of relatively high utilization rates. That's good for a lot of cost reasons. It certainly also reduces carbon footprint to some extent too. And I want to emphasize that the way that they approach this is not centered around JVM. I think that a lot of the open source big data frameworks, of course, are very focused on Java and more recently also, you know, Scala and Clojure, but JVM languages. And a lot of this is historic because, you know, Yahoo sponsored Hadoop, and there's been a lot of spin-offs from Hadoop. They're all pretty much Java-based. But when you look at mixed workloads, it's not Java only. There's a lot of, you know, just web apps and things that run outside of JVM as well. That's an important point. We'll get to it in a minute. I apologize. The slides, when they were transferred over into PowerPoint, there's a little bit of a little bit of it is clipped at the bottom, so you can't see. But one of the main takeaways from looking at what Google's published about data center computing is that scheduling batch jobs, even though there's a lot of them, that's not so difficult. Scheduling services to get high utilization and low latency, that's an extremely difficult problem. And that's where the money is, because the services are where your data is presented to your customers. So that's a lot of the emphasis for Mesos, a lot of the rhyme and reason. Also on this slide here, if you want more of a deep dive where Google's making the business case, Jeff Dean from Google did a great talk at ACM in the Bay Area here last year. It's entitled Taming Latency Variability. And Jeff Dean talks about how they run a lot of these mixed workloads inside of data center computing. And then also illustrates use cases in terms of deep learning, how they're running lots of neural networks for, say, image recognition, things like that. It's a very informative, very entertaining video. So as I mentioned, Google doesn't publish a lot about the proprietary work on data center computing, but there's a few important things that have gone public. One of them is an excellent article by Cade Metz in Wired Magazine early last year. It's entitled Return of the Borg, where there's a compare and contrast between John Wilkes, who's the lead on Google's Omega project, again, for data center computing, and then comparing that with Ben Hinman, who's the main author of Apache Mesos, and sort of a compare and contrast of the project goals for each project, one being proprietary, one being open source. There's also an excellent book entitled The Data Center as a Computer. Barroso and Hosley, you know, some of the engineering leadership out of Google, have written about this topic, and there's recently a second edition. It doesn't drill down into these concepts directly, as far as like Omega and Borg, but it does present the overall philosophy of how to approach apps in a data center computer. And then, thirdly, there's a excellent video from a few years ago by John Wilkes talking specifically about the Omega project and what their goals are for this kind of cluster management. And it's an amazingly frank video, some great insights on how they look at multi-tenancy and mixed workloads. Now, there is one paper that I'll point everyone towards in particular. This was done for the EuroSys conference 2013. The paper itself was actually written in 2012, but it's from Google, and it's entitled Omega, Flexible Scalable Schedulers for Large Compute Clusters. And in this, they take a look at traces that have been published for, like I say, Yahoo, Twitter, Facebook, other companies, as well as Google's traces. And they do a lot of simulations of their large-scale clusters. In fact, some of the simulators they've pushed open source out of this paper. But it's interesting because in the illustrations here, you can see both illustrations have three columns. The left-hand side is what's called monolithic cluster scheduling, and that's what Google's been using for a number of years in a project called Borg. And it provides a lot of flexibility for leveraging data center computing, but there are performance problems with a monolithic scheduler. It tends to hit a performance knee after a certain scale. So the next column, the middle column, is what they call two-level scheduling, and that's an evolution of these ideas, getting rid of some of the performance bottlenecks. And Apache Mesos is characterized in the paper as being a two-level scheduler. They go through some of the rhyme and reason of what a two-level scheduler has to do. So I think this paper is a great resource to understand Mesos. The third column, the right column, is it's what's called a shared state optimistic concurrency. It represents the research goals for the Omega project, what Google is trying to get towards in their R&D. And it's a very complex thing to be able to do shared state. Essentially what that means is that out in the cluster, if you have a process running and you want to take, say, a web app process that's running a little bit too hot, it's a hot spot in the cluster, it's got too many connections, maybe you want to move it over to a different part of the cluster that's less heavily loaded. So it would be nice if you could just pick up that process that's live, that has transactions going, and move it somewhere else without the customers even noticing any kind of interruption. That's an extremely hard thing to do with live traffic, but that's part of the goal of Omega. And that's what this kind of technology, Mesos, is leading towards. So I highly recommend the paper. One caveat, it was written in 2012, you know, about a year and a half ago. There's been a lot of updates to Mesos and Omega both, but in particular, Mesos has added a lot more work with highly available services since that paper was written. So one caveat. All right, so having said that then about these projects out of Google, Mesos is an open source project. It's, it became a top-level Apache project last summer, and so the main website is mesos.apache.org. There's some great resources there. Just to summarize a bit, you know, we talk about open-source data center computing. We talk about Mesos being the kind of common substrate for cluster computing in general. This is not specific to just, say, Hadoop. I think a lot of people hear about Hadoop and think that that's what clusters are for. There's a lot of other reasons to be using clusters. It could be Memcache. It could be, you know, MPI. It could be more real-time or streaming types of frameworks. But the idea of Mesos is to be able to mix it together. And you think about all the resources that you have in your data center. There may be a lot of different types of servers. There's other assets for, you know, your switch fabric, your storage, etc. So the idea with Mesos is to take all those different resources and combine them together to make them look as if it was one giant computer, and then peel off resources as needed for the different kinds of frameworks, the different kinds of applications that have to run, without thinking about the fact that it's 10,000 computers. So it tries to simplify how developers think about distributed processing, distributed systems, and really leverages the operating system to do that. Mesos has been scaled out to tens of thousands of nodes. As I understand, Berkeley has done simulations of up to 50,000 servers in a Mesos cluster. before it starts to hit any kind of a performance need where the scheduler actually introduces some latency for new apps that are being spun up. The other thing, of course, is that this really gets rid of the need for virtual machines. So you run these Mesos clusters, you can run them without using VMware or Xen or anything like that. There's a lot of good performance reasons for that, especially on a heavily loaded cluster. In particular, highly available services hit performance bottlenecks pretty badly on a heavily loaded cluster if there's a virtualization layer. We can go into details about why. I can answer more of that with some examples later. But there's a real big cost to virtualization, not just licensing, but also performance. Now, Mesos has APIs in C++. Most of the kernel code is written in C++. But there's also bindings for JVM, for Java, Scala, et cetera. Also for Python, also for Go is more recent API that's been added. There's a nice console for being able to inspect what's going on in the cluster. And when you are using Mesos, when you're isolating resources, you can determine CPU upper and lower bounds, how much RAM a process is going to be using as like a high watermark. The network controller, you can specify how much of the network controller you get for I/O. There's constraints on the file system, et cetera. But another interesting thing is that C groups allows you to do what's called ad hoc resource tags. So you can define new classes of resources. It doesn't just have to be CPU, memory, et cetera. You can go in and tag a given slave node in the cluster with its rack ID. And then when you fire off, say, 100 processes for a web app, you may want to specify that they're all on different racks so that you try to disperse them. Or you may have a set of processes that you need to run some application where you want them all in the same rack. And so then you specify what constrain it to the same rack ID. So there's a lot of flexibility. You can also use ad hoc resource tags for defining some of the switches, more of the IO networking kind of equipment. And there's a lot of room to grow on that. I think that's a pretty interesting area with software-defined networks in particular. A couple recent articles out of O'Reilly's Strata. We did a couple brief blog posts to give more background and history about Mesos, talk a bit more about the available APIs, different use cases, et cetera. So I definitely recommend those. Ran over the past couple of weeks on O'Reilly's Strata. Okay, so let me jump into a little bit of architecture, and while I'm doing this, we'll start to talk about Spark. When we look at a Mesos cluster, we've got some cluster resources down the bottom, like I say, a bunch of different servers and other assets. Over the top of that, we're going to assume that there's a distributed file system. Mesos really needs that. Borg and Omega, et cetera, they have their own distributed file system to use as well. As a default, Mesos uses Apache HDFS. And then over the top of that, there's a distributed kernel. So you could think of this as like an operating system kernel, but it's distributed all the way across the cluster. And when frameworks run on Mesos, they're just talking to the Mesos driver, but it's essentially sending messages out to that distributed kernel all across the cluster. Over the top of that, we run frameworks using the Mesos terminology. And that may be, say, for instance, Hadoop is a framework, Spark is a framework, Storm is a framework, MPI is a kind of framework. And then over the top of that, we may launch jobs in those frameworks, applications based on Spark or Hadoop, things like that. Or they may just be bash scripts or IPython notebook or something you want to run in a cluster. And this also extends out to other things you want to run, Ruby on Rails, Kafka, Memcache, all kinds of different things you want to run in these mixed workloads. Here's a little more detail on the slide as far as taking a look at the different layers in the stack. I want to point out there's a couple things on the top right. We have a notion of something called a meta framework. So Twitter has a project called Aurora, And Mesosphere has a product called Marathon. Both these are getting a lot of adoption. The idea is that these are meta frameworks, which in turn launch other frameworks. So, for instance, you could run Marathon, and then from Marathon, have it be responsible for making sure that you've got, you know, five job trackers running on your cluster, so you could have five different submit queues for headache. So you can launch other frameworks out of them. There's also a notion of something called a task scheduler, like Kronos, which came out of Airbnb, and that's essentially a distributed cron. So you could run individual jobs out of a task scheduler or the types of scripts. To put this in context, let's take an analogy. When Linux first boots up, when the kernel boots up, one of the first processes that gets run is typically initd. It's a little bit more complex than that, but let's just say, you know, when you're really looking at the processes running, initd is one of the first to run, or maybe upstart, depending on the flavor of Linux. And then from initd, one of the first services to run is cron. And then cron will go out and, you know, launch all the maintenance and stuff going on, the different periodic things that need to happen inside of that Linux box. So there is an analogy here with Mesos. First, the distributed kernel boots up, and then from there, meta frameworks like Marathon provide a kind of distributed initd for running services. And then from there, they can launch Kronos as a kind of distributed cron. And so given those layers, you can launch frameworks, launch jobs, launch other types of scripts and tasks, getting the mixed workloads, getting the multi-tenancy out of your cluster. Now, I've used the term framework. I've mentioned a few times. When we talk about a framework in Mesos, Spark is an example framework. So we called, Google called Mesos a two-level scheduler. Here are the two levels. Down in the distributed kernel, you've got the master. Actually, you should have more than one master, probably like three masters running. So they're highly available. And then you've got all the different slaves out in the cluster. The resources are available out on the slave nodes. That's communicated back through Mesos to the masters. And then the masters make what's called resource offers up to the frameworks. The frameworks, like Spark, have two components. One is a scheduler. Let's say you're launching Spark off of the master. So the scheduler talks to Mesos. It receives resource offers using some kind of algorithm, but like fair scheduler by default. And then it knows about tasks that it needs to run, so it will consume those resource offers, send them out into the cluster on what's called executors, the different task trackers, if you will. Those are running on the slave nodes in the cluster, and those will actually perform the work, consume the resources. Once they're done with it, hand it back to the operating system, and the cycle continues. So those are the two levels in a distributed framework based on Mesos. Okay, let me switch gears a little bit, talk about use cases more. There's a number of public deployments, Twitter being the big one. You know, they talk about up to 150K core clusters that they run. They've mentioned that in some different meetups. Airbnb is another large deployment. A couple others were pretty early on. HubSpot, Media Crossing, both out of Boston. ShareThrough has done some really innovative work on Spark streaming, doing a lot of work with Mesos there, also in San Francisco, and a number of other companies as well. We have case studies on about half of those that I mentioned. There's a lot of other adoption of Mesos, not all public yet. But, you know, we're trying to do case studies as much as possible for what goes public. The Twitter case study, there's a couple of articles, one in Wired, another on the Twitter engineering blog, but Chris Fry, the SVP of engineering at Twitter, has written a lot about how really they leveraged Mesos, number one, to get rid of the fail whale. There was a lot of steps they had to do to get Twitter in shape before their IPO, and Mesos is one of the core components for that. As a result, Chris Fry makes the point that when Twitter engineers build new services now, those are built on Mesos. Okay, now let's go into launching a Mesos cluster. And if you want to follow along on this, I encourage you to, if you have AWS account already, shadow me here and also launch a cluster. There's a service called Elastic Mesos. It's elastic.mesosphere.io. It's a free tier service. It launches Mesos clusters on Amazon AWS. It's just a real simple three steps. We'll go through those. All you need is to have AWS credentials. Also provide your SSH public key so you can get into your cluster. And you also need to provide your email address. This is a free tier service. One thing that's important to note is Mesosphere does not collect or keep any of the credentials. It's all passed through into Amazon. And so you need to have that email address to know, you know, your IP address, et cetera, for your cluster once it's launched, because only you have record of it at that point. Or, you know, you can go into your Amazon AWS console and see where the cluster is running. Okay, I see some questions coming up. I'm going to at least start this part out, and then there's some great questions here, and I'll cover back to those. okay, so the three steps here on elastic.mesosphere.io, if you go to that site, first off, we'll choose the cluster size. There's a couple that are prepackaged. I'm going to use a 6-instance of Amazon M1 Larges. Makes for a pretty good cluster. Out of 6 instances, we'll have 3 Mesos masters and 3 slaves. And then, secondly, I'll enter my credentials. So my Amazon access key and then secret key. You don't want to show your secret key to anybody. And then your public SSH key so that you can actually connect into that cluster. And there are some great tutorials online if you haven't seen how to generate an SSH key before. It's pretty quick to be able to do this from a command line on your laptop. And lastly, give your email address, and it'll ask you to confirm once you launch. And from there, let's see, connecting, standby, what's going on here? Okay, there's a momentary delay while we're getting to the next slide. I'm seeing something about connecting standby, so I don't know if that's any kind of an issue on the network.
We see that as well on our end. We'll try to push it for you and see if it goes through. Are you trying to advance to slide 21 right now?
Yes, exactly. Okay. Thanks, Audrey.
No problem. Let's see if that works. Does that help?
Me. Not yet. There's a couple of questions, though.
There we go.
Okay, so there's a couple of questions. I'll try and catch at least one or two of these while we're getting connected here again.
That sounds great.
Okay, so one question Dana had, how is Mesos different from Hadoop Yarn? Actually, in the O'Reilly blog posts on Strata that I wrote over the past couple of weeks, we addressed that in detail. The answer is they're really different. It's kind of odd because Mesos came out of Berkeley, ECS, what's now called AntLab, and subsequently, you know, I've seen papers coming out of Berkeley AntLab where they draw comparisons of Mesos and Yarn, even though they're substantially different. If you read the Google paper, Google makes the point that Yarn is considered to be a monolithic scheduler. So it's in category with their Borg project, whereas Mesos is a two-level scheduler, which is an evolution beyond that, less performance issues. And then Omega is the R&D goal for Google. So, you know, categorically, they're different in that regard. Mesos is really a distributed kernel. It's running right down in the operating system. It is not based on having JVM up in the stack. So, I mean, I think that, you know, Yarn is awesome for certain things if you're doing batch processing as an evolution of Hadoop. But the world is not made up of just Hadoop clusters. In reality, in industry, you go out in enterprise IT, You know, they're running a lot of Memcache. They're running a lot of web apps. They're running a lot of things that require relatively low latency that will never run on Yarn. So it's not really an apples-to-apples comparison. That's how they're differentiated. Mesos is about mixed workloads. Again, the sort of Google Omega philosophy. And the Omega paper makes some pretty good distinctions on this. Let's see, another question. Okay, the Docker one is good. I'll get to that later. Here's a question from Dan Y. Does Elastic Mesosphere do AWS tagging of the instances so we can query via the AWS API to get the nodes? Yes, they are tagged. You will see that. I'll see if I can show my console a little bit later, and we can take a look through some of the nodes. But it should be pretty obvious that the different clusters are being tagged. Great question. Because then the point of that, ostensibly, is that you could use the AWS command tools to operationalize this and be able to launch clusters from a command line, work it into the rest of your operations workflows. Okay, let's see, other questions. Does Mesos compete with the core OS initiative, or are they orthogonal? More specifically, when looking at Docker and Mesos. Let me get back to that. There's a lot of activity there, and Red Hat in particular has been doing some pretty interesting things. Short answer is Mesos has an integration with Docker in at least one, if not more, ways. And I'll come back to that. I think it's one of the more interesting areas of Mesos usage. Separate from Spark, but very interesting thing. Okay, looks like we got some slides here. So let me jump back into the presentation then. If you launch a cluster through Elastic Mesos on Mesosphere, after a few minutes when the AWS nodes come up, and really most of the time is actually involved in getting ECT nodes spun up, you'll receive an email that has the IP address for your Mesos cluster and also has a few other details. But the important thing is wait for getting that email and then you can proceed. Usually this takes about 5 minutes or so. Okay, we'll try to advance to the next. Let's try slide 23. Okay. Actually, I should ask, is anybody out there trying to run this side-by-side, launch and cluster, while I'm doing this?
Hi, Paco. So we're just having some network connection issues right now, which we're figuring out. But okay. For the audience, just a reminder, if you have a question for Paco, please be sure to put it in the chat room and preface it with a capital letter Q. Also, we do have a deal going on today that's a 48-hour special from O'Reilly. And what we're offering is 50% off Paco's ebook. That's Enterprise Data Workflows with Cascading. And also two other books. I sent out that link just a bit ago if you're interested. And Paco, we'll just wait a couple minutes here. I know you answered a few questions already. Were there any more in there that you could see?
Let me answer that Docker and CoreOS. There certainly are aspects of CoreOS that are orthogonal to this. There could be some overlap. There's structurally some issues there. And that's kind of getting into a lot of the details on Mesos, but, we've had some dialogue and we've definitely been considering that. The best person, I will definitely say that I'm not an expert at that level of Mesos, but I've had some good conversations with Ben Hinneman, author of Mesos. He's at Twitter. And we have a lot of the developer community events, town halls and meetups and whatnot. Jason Dusek at Mesosphere also, we've talked a bit about this in CoreOS. So I'm not going to dig into too much on CoreOS, but Docker is the really interesting part. So for those of you who are not familiar with it, Docker is a way of, it's what's called Linux containers. So if I want to take and run a web app on my Mesos cluster, if it's a Sinatra web app, for instance, a Ruby-based web app, I can just create a tarball of that, and I can go and send that out as my executor. I can send it out to the executors in a Mesos cluster using something like Marathon. And those tarballs will be inflated, untarred, and then there'll be a really simple command just to connect into the directory that's created and run Sinatra. And boom, you've got your web app process running. Some types of things that you want to run are not that simple. They aren't just a tarball. They aren't just a simple command. You actually have to go and update a lot of different parts of what's in the file system, start different pieces running. So, for instance, if I was going to do Django or, you know, something more complex in Python, it isn't just a simple tarball. I'm going to have a little bit more complex deployment. So a nice thing to be able to do is what we call containerize this by using Docker and basically have this container that we can just ship out across the cluster and run it. And it's not based on a virtual machine, so you know the process that you're running is talking directly down to the kernel. There's a lot of efficiencies, but it makes it easier because then effectively you have recipes for how to go out and run things like Redis, for instance. There's a great Docker container for that. The idea in Mesos, what we've done is to work with the Docker team to provide an integration using what's called Marathon, one of the meta frameworks. And you think of running a Docker container as if you were launching any other kind of process. So Marathon goes out, runs Docker across the cluster. Mesos and Docker both work through the LXC libraries on top of cgroups, so there's some good common ground there. There's a few problems with Docker. One of the things that's nice with Mesos is being able to get a lot of statistics about usage in your cluster, again, because you're leveraging multi-tenancy, utilization is really important. And Docker obscures this to some degree. It's something they've been working on. I don't have a good update on that in the last couple months. But I do know that, for instance, Red Hat has been working with both Docker and Mesos, and so there's some pretty interesting integrations there. And I think that's a good story for some of the projects that I'm working on right now. Actually, we're looking at using Docker, most certainly.
All right, and it looks like we have another question from Dan. I'm not sure if you received this already, but he wants to know, does Elastic Mesosphere do AWS tagging of the instances so we can query via AWS API to get the nodes?
Yes. We actually answered that one already. The answer is yes. If you pull up the AWS console, you'll see that the nodes that are being launched in your account for the Mesos cluster, they are tagged. So, again, the benefit on that is then you can use the AWS command tool. There's a Ruby command line to be able to manipulate your clusters, your Mesos clusters, and so you can hook it into the rest of your operations. There are a couple other questions that just came through. For distributed file system, can I use OpenStack Swift? Interesting. You know, I haven't really run across that before. Definitely there's been a lot of conversation about how to use Mesos along with OpenStack in a number of places we've been talking about that. The Mesos distributed file system is pluggable. And, you know, when you talk to grad students, you talk about how they would extend their thesis project, and the default answer is, yes, it's pluggable. That is to say that, you know, they used HDFS as a default, but it can be swapped out. I know that there were discussions about using, for instance, some of, you know, like those IBM products for really robust distributed file systems. So I'll take that back. I'll try to find out more about Swift integrations if anybody's been encountering that. There's really lively Mesos developer community in IRC and in the user and dev email lists, as well as in a lot of the meetups and forums, most of which are sponsored by Twitter, actually. We have some of those up in Seattle next week. But there's a lot in the San Francisco area. And you know, this would be a great question to run in one of the forums just to see if anybody else run across it. Another question that came up was, Shahir, is the source code for Elastic Mesos, ElasticMesos.io, is that open source? No, it's not really. And I don't know that they have any plans to make that open source per se. Frankly, it's a lot of accounting just to make sure that they don't persist any of the credentials. If you wanted to, you could launch a Mesos cluster. There's a recipe for this. Actually, a few of those have been published, a lot of tutorials on the Apache site. You know, so you can end around using this Elastic Mesos service just by running those scripts yourself. But this is a lot more packaged if you don't want to be digging down into that. I've definitely seen some pretty interesting work using Ansible and Puppet and Chef for being able to launch Mesos clusters. There's great tutorials about that. There's also, if you just kind of want to play around with a cluster, maybe not for production use, but there's work on, I think it's called Playa Mesos. Jeremy Lingman had done work on Vagrant VM, so you could bring up a small virtual cluster on your laptop. Okay, let's see if we can advance yet. Still can't advance to the next slides.
I just pushed slide 23 for you. It looks like it came through. Are you seeing it on your end?
Yes. Okay, great.
And Paco, if we run into more issues, we can have the audience. Audience, if you wouldn't mind opening up the slides from your resource folder, which is that widget down at the bottom, dark green folder, and you can access the slides there, and then Paco can talk through them and let you know which slide he's on, and follow along that way if we encounter any more issues with the platform. But right now it looks okay, so let's give it a shot.
Okay, great. Thank you, Audra. Can you advance to slide 24? Maybe we can just go through this verbally. It looks like I can't quite access it on my side.
Yeah, let me see here. There we go.
24.
There it is.
25.
Okay, so it looks like it's up right now with the Mesosphere URL and configure and run Spark on Mesos cluster on AWS in a 7-step tutorial.
Oh, great. Okay. Okay, I'm not getting updates on my slide, so I'm going to cut over to my slide deck as Audra was describing, and then I can talk through. Okay, so slide 24, 7-step tutorial. We wrote a step-by-step tutorial, once you've got a Mesos cluster running, how to run Spark. And a nice thing about this is that if you go from the email that you receive, there's a link to this tutorial, and that link has all of your IP addresses and other parameters URL encoded, so that when you click that link, the tutorial will be populated with exactly the commands for your cluster. Let me advance to slide 26. And so there's a big red arrow on slide 26, if everybody sees that, where there's a line that says, for fast in-memory number crunching, try Apache Spark on Mesos tutorial. And so clicking that, that'll bring up the tutorial on Mesosphere. And I'm going to run through the different steps. Advancing to slide 28, the first step is we need to connect into the Mesos master. So the command line for that, if you look at slide 28 and then slide 29, it's just simply doing an SSH-L Ubuntu, because we're launching Ubuntu Linux in this cluster, and then the IP address for the master. That IP address will change for every different one. Slide 30, and advancing to that, step two, we need to do a little bit of install. So given that we've launched an Ubuntu Linux cluster, got Mesos running on it, we'll need a couple packages. We need to install Git, and we need to make sure that we've got JDK 7. So there's instructions there on slide 31, basically using aptitude to do an install of Git and open JDK 7. And that's pretty quick. That will take a minute or two. Once you've got those loaded, advancing to slide 32, the next step is we need to download Spark and we need to rebuild it based on the kind of environment that we're going to have, based on running a particular flavor of Hadoop. So to download Spark, look at slide 33. There's three parts of this step. First off, we're going to use wget to pull down the Spark tarball. It's specifically it's from the Spark project on Apache Incubator, and we'll be using Spark 0.8.0. And this is the one that's built for using Cloudera CDH4 for the Hadoop. You need to have that because we're going to be running HDFS. So once wget runs, you take and do tar xcf on the tarball, insulate the tarball, and then connect into the directory that's created. Okay, so advancing to slide 34, the next step is we need to build Spark. And Spark is based on the Scala language. So there's the Scala build tool, SBT, is what we use. There's a little bit of a nuance here, though. How we have to build this is kind of interesting. Looking at slide 35, the command line for that is you have to say Spark underscore Hadoop underscore version equals, and then, like I said, we're using Cloudera CDH4. So you need to give it that specific version. It's very important to have that environment variable set. And then SBT, we run that. And importantly, the two commands in the build are clean and assembly. Some of the documentation running around about Spark leaves out the clean step, but it's really critical because we are rebuilding this for CDH4. We need to do a clean first or it won't work down the line. So you do a clean and assembly. That part takes a little bit. That's probably the most costly part of this whole process, is just doing the SBT build. It'll take a few minutes, probably in the order of about 8 to 10 minutes. Once you've done the build, though, the next step is package it all up. And Spark provides a shell script called makedistributions.sh. So advancing to slide 36, the next step is we make the distro. And then once we've packaged that up, we're going to drop that tarball out into HDFS. That way all the different slate nodes in the cluster can pick it up out of HDFS. So slide 37 shows these commands. You do make distribution, and you give it the Hadoop version for HDFS. We're going to take that and move it into a specially named directory, and then we're going to create a tarball out of that directory, and then we're going to copy that out into /temp on HDFS on our shared file system. Okay, great. Now, so what that means is we've built Spark to run with this particular distribution of Hadoop for HDFS, running on our Mesos cluster, and now we've put it out in HDFS so all the different nodes in the cluster can get a hold of this executable. Advancing then to slide 38, we have to configure it specially, final step. So we connect into the conf directory in Spark, and there's a template. It's sparkenv.sh.template. We copy that over into something called sparkenv.sh, and then we'll edit that shell script to provide three environment variables. And these are based off of the cluster that we've received. If you're following the tutorial on mesosphere.io/learn, these variables are all populated with your AWS cluster. But what you need to have is a pointer to where on the file system libmesos, the library, is, and also where in HDFS the Spark executable that we just built, where it's going to live. And, of course, to have that, you need to be able to access that in HDFS, you need to have the IP address for the name node. That's shown here it'll be populated for your cluster though. And then thirdly, you need to point to the master for Mesos. And so we use a Zookeeper URL that has the IP address of the master and port 2181. Okay, so basically you can use Vim to edit that Spark env.sh script, add these three lines, and you're done. Save it, and we'll connect back up out of the directory. Slide 39 shows the commands you need to use. And then from that point, we'll go to slide 40, and we're ready to run Spark. Now, I want to point out that all this stuff about pulling down Spark from Apache and rebuilding it with SBT, doing a make distribution, all of those steps, it was kind of costly. That's the longest part of this. And that really only needs to be used once. Once you've built that executable that you're putting in HDFS, you could save it somewhere. You could drop it into S3, for instance. You don't need to rebuild it every time. But I want to show you all the steps if you want to recreate this yourself. Okay, so assuming that we've done that build and propagated that out in HDFS, the last thing we do is actually run Spark. And in Spark, we have a command line, if you will, a prompt that's called a REPL. And the way to run it is Spark shell is the shell script to execute it. So .slash Spark shell. And that should bring up your Spark. Okay. So slide 41. Now let's talk about running a job in Spark. Slide 42. There's a URL there. If you look at slide 42, it's got a URL to the Spark Apache incubator site. And under examples.html, there's a number of different things you can try out from the Spark REPL. We'll be trying a real simple example, running a filter on a large array of integers. So really, there's only a couple of steps that we have to do to run this job, and those will both be at the command line. Slide 43. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is we've got the Scala prompt, the Spark prompt. We're going to create a variable that's it's a collection of integers. It's named data, appropriately enough, and it's integers ranging from 1 to 10,000. And so if you print that out, then you see you've got this range of integers. Okay, and now we're going to take and wrap that. We're going to parallelize that collection in a different value that's called distdata. So what that's going to do is partition the data and send it out into the different nodes in our Spark cluster. And we see that, you see the line there where it says it's creating an RRD. What's called in Spark, an RRD is the data abstraction. It's a resilient distributed data set. Basically, it parallelizes your data set. Okay, so having done that then, go to slide 44 shows all the commands for this job. And the last line there is where we actually run the filter. So we show that on slide 45. We run distdata.filter, and then the arguments inside of the filter, underscore means current data element, let's say. So underscore less than 10 is our filter. We're going to run through all these 10,000 numbers and filter out everything that's not less than 10. And then we'll collect the results. That'll be our result set. What you should see coming out of it are the numbers 1 through 9, all the numbers less than 10. And so when you run that, hopefully that's, you know, you should see exactly that. This job running on our 6-node Mesos cluster, 3 slaves, these are M1 large instances, so they're dual core. That breaks down to a job this size. We'll get cut up into 8 different tasks. And so when this is running, you can also pull up the Spark console. On slide 46, the Spark console it'll be the IP address for your Mesos master, and it's going to be on port 4040. But I'm showing a screenshot then of this running. This job on 3 slave nodes will take about 12, 13 seconds. If you look at the Spark console after it's run, you'll see that there are 8 out of 8 tasks have succeeded, kind of in the middle. And if you click on that, where it says collect at console, it'll pull up a description of all the tasks that are run. It gives you a little bit of detail what's going on inside of Spark. Now, similarly, there's a Mesos console. If you go to slide 47, again, the same IP address for your Mesos master, and this is under port 5050, should be. Okay, I've got mine running. If you look at that, if you look at the Mesos console, it'll show you a list of all the different active frameworks or previously run frameworks, terminated frameworks, that are running on your cluster. So Spark is a framework, the one that you're running. My screenshot here, I'd run a couple of things, but let's drill down on one of them. Where it says ID and you'll have a number, it'll look like here in the screenshot it shows 81-0001, and it's a Spark shell that's running. If you drill down on that, that'll show more detail on the framework. So advancing to slide 48, you've got these 8 tasks that have run, all out on the executors, on the Mesos slaves. And for each one of those tasks, we've got something called a sandbox. Also, you see where it's showing you, out of all the 8 tasks, which slave it was running on. You can see that there were 3 different EC2 nodes as slaves running these tasks, and one of those actually had more tasks than the other, so 8 tasks on 3 nodes. If you click one of those, click on the sandbox, that'll drill down and show you exactly what happened in that environment out on that slave. So slide 49, we're going to drill down on one of the tasks, and this is great. This is where you can really get a lot of telemetry about what's happening on your cluster. It's showing you for the task what the executable was. There's the Spark tarball that we had built, and so that's what's running out there. It's also captured the standard error and standard out from this particular task running, and that's really great if you're trying to troubleshoot a problem. Like, for instance, I was building a new framework in Python based on Mesos recently, and I could just drill down onto the standard error for any one of the cluster nodes and see where I was having some problem, where I had to troubleshoot some bugs. Hopefully here, of course, we're not going to have those bugs. Spark is pretty well known. If you click on the standard error link, that'll be the same thing as shown in slide 50. And it'll pop up a log of all the console output that's gone onto standard error. Again, this is a really great way to troubleshoot. Mesos updates these logs as new things are appended, so you can kind of just keep the window open and see what's trailing across the console. If you look through there, hopefully there should be nothing that looks like an exception. Should have run the task just fine. All right, so that's running a Spark job on Mesos on AWS. Let's advance then to slide 51. I know we're coming up on time. I want to point out a few resources. Slide 52, we're going to have a Mesos tutorial at Strata. That'll be on February 11th. February 11th. It's a 3-hour tutorial. Ben Hinman, the author of Mesos, is going to be one of the instructors. Florian Leibert and myself will also be the other instructors there. We're really looking forward to the tutorial and hope you all join us there. We're going to have a Birds of a Feather lunch on Wednesday during Strata for Mesos in general. Also, I'm giving a talk on Thursday about Mesos as a kind of SDK, building blocks for new kinds of distributed systems. And that'll be on Thursday. And also, we're going to have office hours if you want to come talk with us one-on-one. I think there's a book signing there, I believe, on Wednesday as well. Slide 53, I've got a newsletter. I try to cover conferences and workshops and events and whatnot, different technologies that are popping up. So I definitely encourage people to sign up for that. I've also got a shared Google Doc that's public. So anything that's happening about Mesos, new presentations, new frameworks, I try to put a note in that shared Google Doc. Please watch that. There should be some good information there. AMP Camp on slide 54, there's a series of events. I've been a TA at one of these. It's really awesome, very hands-on, deep dive into Mesos, Spark, et cetera. Next one will be at Strata. There'll be a great one there. And then finally, on slide 55, there's an event called Spark Summit. Last one we had was in December. Really amazing talk. Every time we have this event, it doubles. So it was like about 500 people last time. Next time it's projected about 1,000. It'll be in mid-year, and I look forward to seeing you there. Those are all the slides I've got. Let me pop back and see what's if we've got any additional questions.
Yeah, it looks like we have a couple more questions here. Dan wants to know, does Elastic Mesosphere 2, oh, let's see here, I actually already asked you that one. There's another question here. So having Spark on top of Mesos means that I don't have to worry about scaling Spark. Mesos does that for me?
Great, great question. Yes, that's exactly it. So it's interesting, you know, Spark and Mesos evolved at pretty much the same time at Berkeley EUCS in the precursor to AmpLab. And that, you know, part of the rationale was they wanted to do research. They had a certain number of nodes that they could run in a cluster. They were running some stuff on Hadoop. They were running some stuff on Spark as they were developing it. They wanted a way to mix those workloads and kind of leverage what Google had been doing out of Borg, et cetera. And so Mesos is the distributed kernel. You can add or remove different nodes on the cluster, and then that gives Spark more resources. So, yes, to answer the question, that means that you don't have to worry about scaling Spark. Mesos is taking care of that under the hood for you. It also means you can run other things alongside. So the results that you produce out of your Spark jobs, maybe there's some different types of machine learning that you're running, those results you probably want to push somewhere else. Maybe they go into Memcache. Maybe they go into, I don't know, MongoDB or something like that. So you probably want to run those in the same cluster, run those multi-tenant. That's an example of mixed workloads. And Mesos, again, provides that ability.
And to follow up on that, can we say the same for Hadoop and Storm on top of Mesos?
Yes, that's a really important point. So working with Hadoop on Mesos, there's a couple things that need to change. Remember there was a diagram that I did that showed two levels. There's the distributed kernel level, you've got your Mesos master and your Mesos slaves. And they have resources, they make resource offers. At the framework level, you've got a scheduler and then all the executors running out on the slaves. Those consume the resource offers. So one of the things that had to change in Hadoop was to subclass a couple parts of Hadoop. The job tracker is effectively the scheduler in a Mesos framework. So you know, that's one thing that has to be rewritten to take advantage of Mesos. And then the task tracker is the executor, and that consumes the resources, runs the tasks. So for Cloudera CDH4, those two classes in Hadoop have been rewritten. That's why we're using a special release of Hadoop when we run Hadoop on Mesos. It's just basically rewriting those two classes. If you wanted to use a different flavor of Hadoop, you just have to rewrite those classes. Pretty much the same code, it's all open source. But I can imagine running that on EMC, MapR, Hortonworks, et cetera. So yes, what that means then is that Hadoop can take advantage of this kind of elasticity that Mesos provides, being able to, for instance, change how many slots are available out in the cluster, how many different slave nodes are available, being able to run more than one job tracker. You know, I mean, some of these things have evolved in Hadoop. Facebook has their own version of Hadoop that they've talked about, some Corona, where they try to mix these things in. Definitely Yarn, MapReduce 2 is trying to do different things as far as having more flexibility with Hadoop. But, you know, Mesos provides this along with being able to mix those workloads with Spark, with Storm, MPI. I've just written another framework based on Python for doing large-scale genetic algorithms. So you could mix these all in together. And I think that you know, on the topic of Hadoop and Spark and Storm, one of the things that I'd point people towards is there's an open source project out of Twitter. Their revenue apps run on this. It's an umbrella project called Summingbird that has Hadoop and Storm and Spark, et cetera, under the hood. You can write your business logic in Summingbird and then just basically flip a switch and have it run on Storm in more real time or run in batch on Hadoop. And then Mesos is a substrate underneath that allows you to run these all together. Great question.
All right. So that's it for questions. You answered most of them throughout the event. So is there anything that you wanted to leave the audience before we finish up today?
One thing I should mention, if you have launched a cluster on AWS, of course, once you're through with it, go back to the email down at the bottom. It's got a link for how to shut down your cluster on Apache Elastic Mesos. If you click that URL, then you can go in and type destroy, and it will shut down your cluster for you. Alternatively, you could go into your AWS console and shut down the nodes that are tagged for your Mesos cluster. But, you know, you just want to make sure you don't leave these running because it will be built. So that was one caveat. I definitely encourage everyone to come talk with us at Strata. We got a lot of great events there, and I look forward to seeing you and really looking forward to the tutorial. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Paco. It was a fantastic presentation. And just a reminder to you all, we will have an archive to you within 48 hours. We do have that deal as well if you're interested to get Paco's ebook for 50% off and the two others that are on the link that I just pushed out not too long ago. So thank you, everyone, for attending. Thank you, Paco, once again. And have a great morning, afternoon, or evening to wherever you all are from. Goodbye.